Right, this is a poem by the Swedish poet. Not sure about the pronunciation of his name, but Gunnar Achlof. And again, I'm not sure about the pronunciation of the poem's title. It's an Ayiasma, which evidently means a wish fulfilling well. The cult of a wish fulfilling well. It sounds a bit strange, but when I thought about it, not really strange, because actually spring, certainly in England, spring quite often would have association with healing, and it would be quite, well, I suppose lords in a way, isn't it? The cult of a wish fulfilling well, in a sense, a healing well. Anyway, enough of that. The black image, framed in silver, worn to shreds by kisses. The black image, framed in silver, worn to shreds by kisses. All round the image, the white silver, worn to shreds by kisses. The very metal, worn to shreds by kisses. And in metal, the black image, worn to shreds by kisses. Oh, darkness, worn to shreds by kisses. The darkness in our eyes, worn to shreds by kisses. All we wished for, worn to shreds by kisses. All we never wished for, kissed and worn to shreds by kisses. All we escaped, worn to shreds by kisses. All we wished for, kissed and kissed again. Maybe I just say why I chose that poem. Well, lots of reasons, but very, very briefly, but the first time I ever heard that poem was Divine Prabha. I was doing a Buddha-filled month-long retreat with her, co-leading the retreat. And she walked into one session and just sat herself down in her rather theatrical way that she had of sitting herself down, and then with no introduction whatsoever, launched into that poem. And again, in a very dramatic style. And it was just kind of stunning, a stunning thing. And I've chosen it because actually, in these conversations over the last however long it's been, she's often come to my mind because, she was also someone from San Francisco and someone I knew when I lived in San Francisco. my mind and my heart, a very strong association with Viveka. And I know she was also a very good friend of Chandadasa, who's hosting all this. So she sort of kept coming up into my mind as a sort of common thread between us. And it was on that retreat, that Buddhafield retreat, that she first started bleeding. She went back to America and was shortly diagnosed with cancer and died about 2 years later.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, and there's other people on this call that her life threads through, I'm very aware. I remember very soon after she died, going through New York and meeting up with Chandradasa and Upayati. And Virya Leela, I think, was there too. I don't know. We were in some kind of loud Italian restaurant in Manhattan, weeping. Here we are, another weep-a-thon, but we were weeping at this. It was just so lovely. I grew up in New Jersey, but I live in California, so it was an opportunity passing through. And of course, they hadn't been able to attend so easily the services we had in San Francisco. So we had almost a little very intimate memorial service of our own in this Italian restaurant, just feeling it, feeling the huge impact. She wasn't someone that you would miss. I mean, it wasn't just when she was dramatically reading a poem in Buddhafield.
I'm sure you can just imagine her doing that, can't you? She was an extraordinary woman.
Yeah. She was, and I, one thing, I feel like Savannah Prabha actually taught me in real practice, really what unconditional love means in the nitty gritty. Because we live together. So actually, Paramananda and I, we moved when this San Francisco Buddhist Center bought the building that is now the San Francisco Buddhist Center. Paramananda, Paramavodi, and I were the first three residents.
Right.
So we moved in, and then eventually Sumana Prabha and I, there are two apartments. She moved in, and we moved to the upstairs unit. And the way we decided we would live together is because it was like two feral cats moving in together. We said, okay, we'll live together. But no one will impinge on the other one in any way. Like, we'll each have complete freedom. Which is maybe not like what some people think the ideology of starting a community should be, but it was really more like a declaration of freedom before we moved in together. But I remember she was so irrepressible that when she would get on phone calls, it was like, the entire apartment and probably the whole block could hear this phone call. I used to drive me crazy, like hearing this whole phone call. And one day I realized it was okay. Like, it just didn't bother me at all. It was just this complete acceptance. Like, rather than thinking, oh my God, for fuck's sake, could you just lower the volume? and it was just, she was so, lovable, really, just, and only the whole package was lovable. You couldn't, you can never take away one bit of her and have it still be like what's so fantastic and irrepressible about her. So I really appreciate her for getting the kind of part of me that needed somebody else to take a certain shape to be okay, like just to say to that part, you know what, that's not true. It's okay. We're okay. one of the poems I almost chose to read, Paramananda, is one you wrote for her after she passed, which is so beautiful also, because it, I don't know if you remember the poem you just read, actually, because it's kind of mournful and loving at the same time, but you evoke the grasses and the California poppies of Chikoji, this retreat center we'd all be at so many times, and the blue sky there. And it was your kind of memorial poem to her. So she really wasn't there, because we never talked about it, but it was one of the poems I was really thinking of. You two had a kind of poet-to-poet, heart-to-heart connection, yeah? I mean, you both loved poetry so much, and you both write poetry.
Yeah, we both like drinking.
A lot of poets like drinking, don't they?
I hardly touch a drop these days. Them Californian bars, you know. A cheap cocktail. I'll do this. But yeah, no. I don't know. We've connected on all sorts of levels, really, but certainly on a poetic level. But yeah, on lots of levels. But, I mean, I think the thing about her, I think. I don't want to get this wrong, I think it's Plotinus that says that something's beautiful when it follows its own nature, you know, something like that, yeah. Beauty is when something follows its own nature. And I think she was just herself, wasn't she? There was no veneer, you know. You just got it. I mean, sometimes you could be completely bloody outrageous. Oh, God, you can't say that. I mean, I've sometimes done retreats when I'm sitting there thinking, you can't say that, you know. You can't be saying that. But there, she was just saying it, and it's fine, of course. You know, absolutely fine. But she was just here. She was, which, of course, was also quite neurotic sometimes and quite depressive, but it was all just so there, I think. I mean, she was just, I don't know, you know, I think she was just fantastic. That's, I think, the thing is, I don't know, I mean, this is probably a little unfair, really, but I think sometimes you meet people that are sort of involved in the so-called spiritual life, you know, and you have a kind of feeling that they're trying to be something, and perhaps that they're not quite, which, you know, in a way it's got its positive, I suppose, it's an aspiration to be better, which is obviously positive, but it's like, you don't get that feeling that, well, here's someone just being who they are, you know. No. Yeah. Well, you know what I mean. And I think, I think that's what was so surprisingly and so refreshing about her, and made such a deep impression on so many people. It gives people, doesn't it, when anybody can be who they truly are, it gives other people confidence and permission to be who they are. I suppose that's a bit of a touchstone for me when it comes to what we're trying to do with practice, what we're trying to move towards. It's a bit sort of ridiculous, really, or paradoxical or something, that really all this practice we do, we're just trying to get back to Well, this is one way of looking at it, isn't it? We're trying to get back to, well, whatever, what do you want to call it, our original faith, just who we really are. You know, just trying to get back to the sort of the Taoist established image, and the uncarved block. I really love that image.
Yeah, that is even a Zen version of it, which is your face before your parents' face, which maybe in a culture with, the universal and the particular together. I'm here in the hills of Northern California, and I'm looking at this, the view out the car window right now is these golden grasses. We evoke this image already from Jokoji, where we'd be on retreat. California golden grasses in the high summer when they're dry, you know, and just glowing in the sun.
Oh yeah.
And the last retreat I was on with Sivana Prabha, she was already quite ill. It was our summer month-long retreat. And she was just barely able to be there. We figured out how to support her, you know, all the creating a bed for her in the shrine room, so when she had the energy to join us, she could just lay down and all these kinds of just taking care so she could be there. So it's very, I think, for our whole Sangha, a really sweet memory of being with her in this time of the golden grasses. And her name meant, you know, golden radiance. So whenever we're in Jokoji, I always felt like she was so at home there, and also just the goldenness of it always felt. She looked particularly who she was, whatever that, you know, her preceptor, Sangha Devi, named her well, I think, you know, captured something in that name, golden radiance. But there was on that retreat a teaching from Dogen, which I found really beautiful, which speaks to what you're saying, which is describes how there's a field of grass, and there's so many different kinds of grasses as you look closely at any field of grass, you know, but if you get closer, there's so many different kinds of myriad forms of this grass and what we call grass, this field of grass. And he says, surely you must know emptiness as the most beautiful field of grass. So the simplicity of that image, you know, if you spend a summer, a month living in this grass, and hearing an image like that. Yeah, and it's just, you know, for each stalk just to be as it is. So we had this ritual where each person went and found three different kinds of grass for themselves. They just had this time to go find three different kinds of grass and bring them to the shrine room, and we made a one offering bouquet of this beautiful grass together. It was really beautiful, and it was like that. It was like, it's so beautiful when that multiplicity, you know, that complexity of what any one person might be, what we might have a fantasy of who they are. It's just so ungraspable, you know, and to love that rather than fear that is such a, I think that probably is like one way we could describe awakening, you know, as an embodied, deeply human experience.
The thing was, I mean, not that I saw that much of her in the last 2 years, but I mean, I did come out and see her, and also from what other people said, and the impression I got was those last 2 years of her life were in some of the happiest years of her life.
Mm.
And she was kind of luminous, you know. That was the impression I got. She was sort of luminous in that period. And people just wanted to be with her, didn't they?
Yeah, it was really like, she was so welcoming. People around her were kind of trying to help pace the number of visitors, because really it would have been like a scene from that sutra, the Vimalakirti Nirdesha, where there's like millions of beings magically in one room. Yeah, she's so generous.
She's so generous. She's a bit like, I don't know, you might, a long, long, long time ago, I read it, but that, the heart is a lonely hunter. Have you ever read that book, The Heart is a Lonely Hunter? But I think he's deaf and mute, but all these people come to see him, and he sort of blessing goes on. It's more like he blesses them just by his presence. And I got that impression with her. It was more like people were coming to see her. I mean, obviously, in a way, they were coming to see her to say goodbye, but they were sort of coming to see her to be blessed.
That's right. Yeah, they wanted to, I don't know, I can't say what people wanted, but in my imagination, or the best I could sense, yeah, there was this wanting to be in that, bask in that golden radiance, you know. And she was like, something in her had opened up to, you know, this, yeah, the channel was open, you know, so to speak. I mean, we were like siblings, little Dharma siblings, so we had our, you know, we had our struggles, right? Like, because we came into this community almost at the same time. Had all our growing pains together, you know, so it was like a kind of a sibling relationship with all its kind of struggles too, you know. So I remember when she died, I mean, she was so loved and she was so luminous, you know, in those last few years. I remember feeling it like just being with the complexity the whole time of my relationship with her, you know, because it felt like it could almost be a betrayal to say, man, that woman could be a pain in the ass, or my ass, too. So that was also, I'm grateful for that teach. I mean, even after she passed, there was this teaching of like just letting that be true, too. And that was, I think, part of the fuller picture of her, really, because, as he said, sometimes she'd say things and you'd just be like, I can't believe you just said that, you know. Now that you've said that, things are just going to be so much more like difficult.
I mean, I could, well, I'm sure you could as well. I said you could tell some stories about her when they're fit for consumption. Anyway.
One of the, I don't know if I should, I'm going to say this now. If this is one, like, in Subhanu Prabhu spirit, I don't know if I should say this, but I'm going to just say it. One of the last talks we did together, we had a really dear friend. Our lives in the Sangha can be so interwoven. We had a really dear friend who, we practiced with for a long time within the Triratna community. And then, you know, something in him that was more like a shamanic healer. That was truly like what he was on this planet to do. So he fully followed that call. So he ended up studying quite deeply within the Peruvian plant medicine traditions of, at both the coastal and mountain shamans in Peru, you know, what we call Peru. And I'm sure there's other indigenous names for those places that I'm not aware of. So he studied quite deeply and he was becoming a plant medicine healer. He was, you know, that was manifesting. He became a channel for that. And because we were dear friends over a long time and we had shared some part of the spiritual life together, he wanted to share that with us. I'm not sure I ever particularly wanted to, like I wasn't someone for whom doing ayahuasca was on my bucket list or anything, but it was kind of like it was a request that we do this with him, and you know, very intimately, like the three of us, he wanted Savannah Prabha and I to do this with him. And Savannah Prabha and I, you know, checked in about it, and we both thought, yeah, it's an old friend and there's something he wants to share with us from the heart, you know. So and we were just like a yes. It was kind of like something we said yes to together. And so we went on this shamanic healing journey with his friend. It was such a beautiful thing because we're really surrendering together, you know, we talked about there's a field of grass and I'll meet you there, just lying down on the earth, but just to lie down next to each other.
Yeah.
You know, out of a shared friendship. And say like, yeah, we trust you. And I trust myself and I trust to be on this journey with you, and let's go. Let's see where this takes us. It's almost more than what happened, I think, just the willingness to lie down together in that way. I think she was someone who could hold that field of, well, whatever happens, you know, there's no part of this that's outside the circle of welcome, or, you know. She welcomed brokenness. I think that was it. She was quite tormented, and she, it wasn't, as you said, she had depressive tendencies, yet she, through that honest relationship with that, you know, and that in other people too, and it became this channel of luminous golden love. So there's the teaching there.
I suppose this, you know, for me, it's such a interesting and important area, this whole area of, you know, the healing is through the wound, you know, this is a sort of shamanic idea, isn't it? The healing takes place through the wound. And I mean, I think she kind of exemplified that in a way, you know, that she did have, she had a lot of darkness actually, but she was able to go into that in a creative way, you know. And I think for me, that's always been one of the real of the whole kind of this whole kind of spiritual endeavor that doing me and probably most of the people listening to this, to some degree or other, involved in this kind of spiritual endeavor, and, you know, and this idea of somehow the vulnerability or the wound being a doorway, an entrance into, you know, it seems sort of seems fundamental to me. And actually, the older I've got, I mean, it's always been there right from the beginning. The older I've got, the more importance I think it's assumed, you know, this somehow this turning towards the vulnerability, which might be a personal vulnerability, it might be a personal traumatic theory, but it's also, it might not be that. It might just be the fragility of being a human being, you know, the vulnerability of being a human being, just turning towards that more and more, or, you know, yeah. Where it, to me, it operates on all levels, doesn't it? know, whether it's an individual psychological level, how do you find love for those parts of yourself which actually, from a sort of egocentric perspective, you reject, you know, those rejected parts of ourselves? How do we find love for that on an individual psychological level? But then, you know, on an existential level, I'd say it's just, well, it's just the fact that we're all going to die, isn't it? The journey's always, the healing's always towards death, if you like. And then, of course, on social and political levels, it also manifests, you know, how do we find love in the struggles that we're engaged with, whether they're personal struggles, psychological struggles, political struggles. You know, how do we find love and healing in those struggles?
Yeah, when I first heard the poem of today, upon you reading it today, the instant association for me was it being here in the U.S. And healing, turning towards the healing of our wounds from the way in which race has been constructed and weaponized. I've said this before, but in some imagination, turning towards the wound, any wound, the fear of it probably would be for there to be shame and blame, imagining, I think this is maybe before even a conscious thought that the body maybe shrinks back from turning towards the wound. It's almost like how a wound literally, when it's fresh, you know, there is this flinching, when you come near it. And I feel like around what I'm seeing in around the history of race, which of course is bound up with the history of colonialism. So, you know, I think that often people that are not in the U.S. maybe too quickly say, well, that's a U.S. problem. I know that I'm talking to people in the U.K. where the history of the colonial relationship of the project of the British Empire, you know, and is something to reflect on as well. It's always a good opportunity to turn towards healing, you know. And the image is torn to shreds by kisses. It's so Whoa. Strong. It's like it's not that worn to shred by kisses. Yeah, so that's a very different image than, you know, being shamed or blamed. Yes, worn to shred by kisses. Yeah, I mean, which it implies that there's some labor or there's some weariness that can come, but it's also like some blessing that can come from returning to the wound. You know, the blessing, I guess, in the language we're speaking in could be this some channel of love and healing opening up rather than a kind of, I suppose when we're trying to keep something at bay, there is this tension or there is a fragility, a specific kind of fragility that comes from trying to keep something at bay, which is not the kind of liberating type of fragility, you know, which is maybe the more liberating type of fragility is one in which we really fully turn towards our fragility.
I was just gonna say that poem, I mean, I don't know, but I assume he's talking about an icon. That's the image I always get, you know, the black image framed in silver. So In the Russian and Greek Orthodox Church, very often the icons are framed in that very pale silver, that white silver. And of course, they kiss the icons, and they will wear them out. They will literally wear them out by kissing them. And the interesting thing about the icon. The icon plays a really pivotal role in the split between the Orthodox and the Catholic Church. Yeah? But when the Eastern and the Western Church split, Christian Church, one of the main contentions, one of the schisms was about the nature of the icon. And in the Orthodox Church, the icon, the Holy Spirit is in the icon. So what that meant was that the individual worshipper had direct access to God through the icon. Didn't need a priest, didn't need a church, didn't need an intermediary. They had direct access to God through the icon. And the Catholic Church said, no, no, icons are just a picture, they're just pointing to God. They do not possess the Holy Spirit or whatever you want to call it. But so very interesting sort of history, but also this idea that we've got direct access to stuff through our hearts. I find this such a powerful idea because actually it's got so much implication, hasn't it? That if we believe we've got direct access to things through our heart, actually that gives us tremendous power. It means we're given, we're activated. We can do something about, well, you know, you're talking about racism. We can do something about racism because we can feel it directly in our heart. When we feel things directly in our heart, yeah, it can be really painful. It is really painful. But it's also very, very powerful. Gives us power. We don't need an intermediary. Just as in this Orthodox Church, they didn't need a priest. We don't necessarily need politicians or whatever, blah, blah, blah. We can do something. And then I think for us as a practitioner, or Buddhist, or whatever we want to call ourselves, it's so important to believe that we can do something. We can have some sort of effect in it. I mean, this comes back to Savannah Prabha, doesn't it? Because she just did things, you know what I mean? She just did it, didn't she? You know?
Yeah.
She just kissed that icon directly.
Yeah.
She'd wear that fucking icon.
She was French. She was French.
You know what I mean? She would wear.
She was French kissing the icon.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, and I wonder for you know, she had lived such a messy life that well, I just wonder for us, the thing about. Being, you know, she got to the point of being drawn towards messiness, you know, and you were talking about in a previous conversation we had, you know, there's this, if you can learn how to be in relationship with vulnerability, there can be a holding. We were talking about this in terms of like what ideally a teacher can do, a Dharma teacher or a meditation teacher, or any kind of mentor that's trustworthy, I guess, is that they're in relationship with the vulnerability and the messiness, and they're including their own, but they can hold ground. They can hold, they're not, they're not, yeah, I think that one thing I really hope that we take Buddhist training and apply it towards is this, because I'm sometimes mystified that, you know, people can do all this mindfulness training and, you know, learn about, oh, I'm going to be present with all sorts of sensation. Like in theory, I'm going to be present with all sorts of sensation. And, you know, in theory, I'm not going to identify with it, whatever that means, and in people's fantasy, and they practice. And then It comes to a moment, an encounter with heat, you know, usually across some kind of difference or something in an encounter that triggers something. And I've seen this most recently around just even, you know, racism is what I call a third rail conversation. So in the train tracks, as a metaphor, there's a third electric rail. And so when you touch that rail, it's like high voltage, right? Like in the train tracks. So it's like a third rail conversation in that it's like, if you touch it, it's got charge, it's got heat. And, you know, to be able to be healers and anything with charge or heat, and of course, race is only one of the things in our collective, our co-creation of samsara, that is heat. There's all sorts of, you know, for each of us, so many things that have that charge. But, you know, our training, I would say, for it to be at all like actually practically conducive to the ending of suffering, in a way, it's not to ignore suffering, yes, to actually be able to be with suffering. And that training, if something causes that flinch and you just sort of project it out and start being angry, you know, at the person or the thing, the topic that supposedly charges, you know, brings about your anger. I mean, in this conversation of recent days, in the days after, you know, this the murder of George Floyd really caused this heightened consciousness about the murderous quality of racism. I've noticed, you know, people get angry just about wanting to talk about racism. That can like invoke so much fury, how does our training come in there? There's a wound, of course, that's a huge flinch. I appreciate that flinch. How can we meet each other? How can we use our training rather than to like, that's it, game over, you know, cut off. How can that be a moment of almost seeing the sacredness of that moment? Like, wow, this has so much heat. There must be something worth paying attention to. You know,
It's interesting what you're saying, isn't it? That third rail, and then, you know, that being charged, and coming back to this icon, the idea of the icon being charged, and actually being charged with the Holy Spirit, you know, a direct contact. Both of them are, you know, this idea of things being really charged. And I do think, I don't know if this is quite what you mean, but I do think sometimes people can use meditative practice as a way of trying to decharge things, you know? And actually, that doesn't seem quite right to me. Do you know what I mean? It's a bit hard. It's not actually numb out, but kind of rise above things, or, you know, it's an ascension model where you're kind of ascending above the messiness of being a human being, because it is a messy business, isn't it, being alive in this world, you know? It's a messy business, the relationship with people, being, you know, within societies, and, you know, trying to live with each other, you know, it's a messy business. And yeah, you do have this tendency in a lot of religious traditions of this isolating or rising above, or, you know, turning away from the messy business of living. And I suppose for us, we used to be called the Western Buddhist Order, didn't we? I know that there's some problems with that. That old title, because obviously in some ways it's not that appropriate, but it did have something I liked about it, because it did imply we've got to find a way of what does Buddhism mean now in this contemporary consumer post-capitalist consumerist culture we're living in now. What's it got to offer us now? What can we contribute to this society we've got now? Because I think that whole the whole kind of translating this is very, you know, it's an old tradition, isn't it? And finding new ways of living it and expressing it and communicating it and understanding it seems to me a vital, well, potentially a very useful and vital thing for this. I don't know, I sometimes don't feel entirely optimistic about the way things are going. You know, I'm sure a lot of people share that. You know.
We're almost at, just so you know, Paramananda, we're almost at 10 minutes to go.
Well, you mentioned something about healing. Say something optimistic for that.
Yeah, well, I'm going to move beyond. Apparently on all the personality tests, I'm like off the charts optimistic, but I'm going to do something else, but just, you know, sort of move towards, there's a phrase we have, like among, when I'm working with activist leaders, there's like a freedom from what we call performing hope. You know, so much pressure to perform hope, which is kind of this inauthentic, oh, well, you know, you slap on the end, oh, well, we'll be okay, you know, and it doesn't have much gravitas. It doesn't. So what I feel like maybe these days I'm leaning into more is, which is what I love about this poem too, the feeling of the poem you're bringing is imagining what we're doing as participating in a healing process. And immediately that brings out in me more sensitivity, I think, in a sense that's quite a bit more, which a robust sensitivity, you know, a committed kind of like the bodhisattva ideal kind of sensitivity to turn towards the suffering of the world. And in participating in healing, it kind of, it's a little bit of a potential middle way, you know, not in the extreme of the hero savior and not in the extreme of the completely powerless, right? I don't know what, victim. There's the middle way of just participating in our world. Yeah, and then the possibility of healing, which in these days, you know, when COVID-19 first started, I the medicine Buddha, which is one of the archetypes of Buddhism, started coming to me. I never really related to that particular, I guess that's an icon we have, you know, the different forms of enlightenment and how they can appear archetypally. And it sort of struck me like, oh, this is sort of an interesting archetype, you know, a force of literally with a pandemic, but just the force of healing that we need, and that what's a deeper healing we also need, you know. And then all this, the deeper wounds of how, and there's different classes in our society, how this pandemic forces you have available to you, and you know, what kind of conditions are available to you for safety is very different depending on, you know, where you're located. So yeah, this something about healing.
Yeah, well, the word pandemic is an interesting word, isn't it? Because it's presumably it's from Pan, isn't it? God Pan. So just like panic and pandemic, you know, they come from the Pan, the God Pan, is of course nature God, isn't it? So it's some sort of severance. Some kind of just severance from nature implied in it somehow. You know, that we've turned away from that wild unconscious side of ourselves, and part of the healing, isn't it? It's somehow coming back into relationship with the world. You know, the world loves us, really. Of course.
I thought, we need to heal Buddhism as well. You know, Buddhism has taken on Yeah, I mean, there's so much sexual misconduct about how the forms of Buddhism have translated, you know, and power. And so there's healing of Buddhism that I hope we can turn to as well, you know, that along the way, we don't only project outwards, you know, that there's this kind of simultaneity of, healing everything, you know, why not?
if we do some more, maybe we can open that can of worms. That would be an interesting thing to look at, wouldn't it?
Mm.
Healing Buddhism, yeah.
Yes, it would. Yeah. Next series, season two. Shall we shift Paramananda to a meditation?
You want the five again, and you do a meditation, yeah?
You'd read the
poem. I'll do the poem, and then you do a meditation. Yeah? You're breaking up a bit.
That's the state of my life. I'm cracking up a bit.
You're cracking up a bit.
Yes, that's right. Yeah.
Well,
yes,
yeah.
Please.
That's how the light gets in, isn't it? Crack up.
Yeah. Okay. Yes. I am cracking up generally, but yeah, I'll stop my video, which might help.
Ayiasma. The black image, framed in silver, worn to shreds by kisses. The black image, framed in silver, worn to shreds by kisses. All around the image, the white silver, worn to shreds by kisses. The very metal, worn to shreds by kisses. Framed in metal, the black edge, worn to shreds by kisses. The darkness, oh, the darkness, worn to shreds by kisses. The darkness in our eyes, worn to shreds by kisses. All we wished for, worn to shreds by kisses. All we never wished for, kissed and worn to shreds by kisses. All we escaped, worn to shreds by kisses. All we wished for, kissed and kissed again.
We'll just hold space together. There's nothing extra you need to do, and perhaps the invitation could be with each exhale, doing less to brace the body against life. Bracing on the inside, bracing on the outside, softening. For a moment, we create a community where you don't need to be better to be here. You don't need to be a better version of whatever is just here. Fully welcome. Just participate in the blessing of golden light, golden light. Radiating, permeating. Every tender being, every wound, illuminating the original face. Om Mati Hum Swaha. Om Mati Hum Swaha. Om Mati Hum Swaha. Om Mati Hum Swaha. Om Mati. Thank you, everyone, and thank you especially Paramananda. It's been thank you for saying yes to connecting. I felt it's been medicinal for me to meet you in these conversations over these weeks. It's been healing. Thank you for your medicine.
Thank you.
Yes, thanks to both of you. There's lots of things I'd love to say, particularly about Suvarna Prabha and you two as friends over the years, to me, to so many people. Yeah, it's been a real honor and sort of privilege to kind of sit in on your conversations together. We can do all the negotiations behind the scene to find $1 million contract to sign you up for season two. Or something. Healing Buddhism sounds like quite a good start.
Topic close to your heart.
In the chat, way back, if you scroll back in the chat, which you can save at the end, you'll find a bunch of links to stuff around Suvarna Prabha if you don't know who she is. And I'd really recommend and clicking on them. You can listen to some conversations that I recorded with Suvarna Prabha as she was dying, quite close to when she died, just reflecting on her life and also on her becoming an Anagarika, which was a big thing she did towards the end of her life. You can also hear the memorial services and just the kind of outpouring of love. And you can also get her ebook where she reflected on her illness, kind of very close to the point where she died. It's a very beautiful book. Just sort of somebody's very graceful passage out of this life into whatever happens next. You've got a picture there.
I have.
Paramananda.
So if you can see that.
We can all kiss our screens and tear the image to shreds. If you pull it back a little bit, Paramananda, and to your left. There you go, that's Paramananda and Svarnaprabha. A little further to your left, just so that you get my reflection out of the way. There you go. Perfect.
Me and her on that Buddha filled retreat, actually. That's the last retreat I did.
If you can support us and the work we do on the Buddha Center Online, we would be really happy if you did. Events like this, much as they feel like magic, don't just happen by magic. Although the internet kind of is magic, isn't it? It's like amazing, isn't it? Viveka's in her car. I don't know if your video can come back on, Viveka, but Viveka's in her car in California, and Paramananda's in West London, and I'm in the East Coast of the US, and I can see Karunadi nodding from Wales and various other people. So, you know, it's magic. We're taking part in magic, but it does take quite a lot of resources to keep it going. So if you can support us, go to thebuddhistcenter.com/give. And if you can't, it's all done by Dana, and you are welcome.